Well, welcome to week two, video one for PSC 355. And in this video, we're going to discuss the factor model of trade preferences. Now, our central question in this video is going to actually be the same question we ask in the next two videos. So all three videos this week will center on this question. And that is, what explains governments' trade policy choices? In other words, why do, say, some governments opt to open up their economies to foreign competition, while other economies or other governments choose to protect their economies from foreign competition? Similarly, we might ask, for instance, why one government may decide to protect a certain sector of the economy, let's say agriculture, from foreign competition, but allow another sector, say manufactured goods, to be open to free trade and foreign goods. So in other words, what explains that variation in government policy choices over trade policy? Now, the approach we're going to look at today, as well as in the next video, is what we might call a society-centered approach to trade policy choice. In other words, this approach assumes that national policymakers intervene in the economy in response to pressure from domestic interest groups. In many ways, this is how I think we tend to believe that politics works and policymaking works in democracies. We elect representatives, and those representatives represent our interests, and therefore they implement policies that are aligned with our interests. And this is essentially what these two approaches, the factor and the sector model, which we'll discuss in the next video, assume. Now, these two models, the factor model and the sector model, we're going to discuss the first of these in this video, are similar in many respects. They both agree that raising and lowering trade barriers is going to raise the income of some in society and lower the income of others. In other words, it redistributes money within society. They also agree that these income consequences of trade are the source of trade policy preferences. That is, if you're a winner from free trade, then you're going to prefer free trade, and if you're a loser from free trade, you're going to oppose it. They disagree, however, on how trade affects how the trade effect of income divides society. That is, they disagree on who the winners and losers are from free trade, and this will become clear as we work through the videos today. So, to begin with, to discuss the factor model of trade preferences, we need to understand or at least go over the basic factors of production, that is, the resources required for generating goods or services in any economy. At the most basic level, there are three factors of production: land, labor, and capital. Now, it's also important to understand that different industries vary in what's called factor intensity. Factor intensity means the relative importance of one factor versus others in the production of a particular good. So, for instance, some industries are labor intensive. These are production processes that require large amounts of labor, many, many workers, to produce its goods and services. So, for instance, the apparel industry, making clothing, tends to be a relatively labor intensive manufacturing process. So is mining. Takes a lot of miners to go down and extract resources from the earth. Agriculture can be labor intensive as well. Also service industries like running a hotel. On the other hand, other industries can be capital intensive, right? These are businesses or processes that require large amounts of money or other resources in order to produce the good or service. So for instance, telecommunications, right? When we think about getting our internet provided for us, we're not thinking necessarily about a lot of workers that provide that internet, but there's a significant investment in infrastructure that costs a lot of money, and a lot of money to maintain that infrastructure as well. Airlines also are very capital intensive. So in other words, we can just at the most basic level understand that industries are going to vary in terms of their factor intensity. Some are going to use labor more, others capital more, others land more. Now, what does this have to do with trade? Well, trade affects the price of the different factors of production. We can think about the price of factors of production in simple terms. The price of labor is the wage rate, what you earn for working, say, an hour. The price of land is the rental or the sale rate for that land. And the price of capital, in the most basic sense, is the interest rate, what you get in exchange for loaning out your money. Factor prices largely determine the income of those who own the factors. In other words, hey, if you're a worker, if you're a laborer, then the wage rate, what you earn for working, is largely going to determine your income. If you're a capitalist, Well, the return on your investment, the interest rate that you get for your money, is largely going to determine your income. The factor model, which is based on something called the Stolper-Samuelson theorem, derives the effect of international economic activities on factor prices. In other words, it says, look, we can tell you how trade is going to affect the price of the factors of production. Stolper-Samuelson theorem, which again is synonymous essentially with this factor model, says that free trade raises the income of those who own the locally abundant factor and reduces the income of those who own the locally scarce factor. On the other hand, protectionism raises the income of those who own the locally scarce factor and reduces the income of those who own the locally abundant factor. The logic of Stolper-Samuelson, the factor model, says that under autarky, under total closure, no trade, the abundant factor is going to be the low price factor. In other words, then, goods that rely primarily on the abundant factor are going to be lower in price. On the other hand, the scarce factor of production, the factor of which there's fewer, is going to be the higher price factor. And so that means that production processes that rely on that scarce factor are going to be higher in price. Under free trade, the abundant factor, goods produced using that abundant factor, which again are going to be the cheaper or lower price good, are going to be exported because they're competitive, right? It's a cheaper good. And better prices for that are going to exist abroad. On the other hand, the scarce factor, the higher price good, now is going to face new competition from imports that are lower in price, more competitive. Let's look at a couple examples. This will continue to make more sense as we work through this. So let's imagine here for a moment that we have two markets. We have a domestic economy. And in this market, right, capital is the abundant factor. There's a lot of money, right? But maybe not as many workers. And because there's so much money, the return on capital is relatively low. There's a lot of capitalists trying to lend out their money, and so a lot of supply, relatively low demand, and so therefore the return on those investments is small or low. So production processes that rely on capital are cheap. On the other hand, in the international market, capital is relatively scarce. There isn't enough money to go around to fund those capital-intensive industries. So the price of capital, is it going to be higher or lower in the international market? Or in other words, we might ask the question, where is the price of capital going to be higher? If you said the international market, then you're correct. Capital is going to be a higher price good in the international market because of its scarcity. Now let's look at another example. Let's imagine now we're looking at labor, and a domestic market has scarce labor. The international market has abundant labor. So where is the price of labor going to be higher? If you said domestically, then you're correct, right? There aren't enough workers to go around. Workers are able to bargain for higher wages in this domestic market. Now, let me give you an example scenario that should make a little bit more sense as we walk through this. And this will build on our example from trade a few videos ago. Let's imagine that we have only two countries in the world, the United States and China. Both countries produce only two goods, shirts and computers. Both possess two factors of production, labor and capital. And we're going to assume that shirt production relies heavily on labor and computer production relies heavily on capital. So, what sort of trade pattern should we expect under free trade? Labor-intensive shirts, should they be exported or imported from labor-abundant China? Labor is abundant in China, So therefore, labor is the low-priced factor of production. So shirts should be produced more cheaply in China. So should shirts be exported or imported? If you said export, you got it right. Now, what about computers? Computers are capital intensive. They need more money than workers, let's say. And so therefore, we know that China is capital poor, even though it's labor abundant. So should computers be imported or exported? You said import, you're correct. Now, what about capital abundant America? Should it import or export labor intensive shirts? It should import, right? Because yes, it's capital abundant, but it's labor poor. And therefore, those cheaper shirts produced in China, because workers work for less money, are going to be more competitive. And so you should buy those cheaper shirts from China. On the other hand, computers are going to be produced more cheaply in the United States because capital is abundant and it's a capital intensive industry. So the price of that good is going to be lower and therefore more competitive abroad. So what does all this mean for trade preferences? Well, let's walk through this. If the United States starts importing shirts, then labor intensive production of shirts in the United States, is it going to increase or decrease? It's going to decrease, right? You have fewer workers now producing shirts in the US. On the other hand, if the US starts exporting computers, the capital intensive production of computers, is it going to increase or decrease? Now you're producing computers for a new market. It's going to increase. So in other words, right? Decline in labor-intensive shirt production means a reduced need for workers. On the other hand, an increased production of computers means a greater need for capital, more demand for capital. So, under the factor model, who are the winners and losers under free trade? Well, in labor-abundant China, do you think the workers win or do they lose? They win, right? Because now there's more demand for what they produce. There's greater demand for workers, which means they should earn, all else equal, higher wages over time. What about capital owners, though, in China? They lose, right? Because now there's decreased demand for capital in China, because that production of computers is going to be moved largely abroad into the US. What about in the United States? Are workers labor owners? Are they winners or losers? They're losers, right? Because again, there's a decline in the demand for labor-intensive production. So workers are going to be laid off or their incomes are going to fall. On the other hand, capital owners in the US, they're going to win, right? Because now there's increased demand for the factor of production that they own, capital, and so they're going to earn a higher return on those investments. So the factor model, or the Stolper-Samuelson theorem, is useful because what it does is it gives us a theoretical model that tells us what the distributional effects of trade are within states, the winners and losers. Benefits owners of abundant factors, trade does, but it hurts owners of scarce factors. And this can help us understand why trade is a divisive political issue. Hey, I'm going to lose my job if we open up to free trade. Or I'm going to end up with more of an income if we open up to free trade. So the factor model gives us simple, elegant predictions for lobbying. We would expect that owners of the abundant factor, the winners, are going to call their representatives and say, hey, we want free trade, perhaps even organize into interest groups and fund politicians that represent those interests. On the other hand, owners of the scarce factor, the losers of free trade, should lobby against free trade or lobby for protection. And so, to come full circle back to our question, what explains government policy choices? The factor model would say, well, what explains it is the relative balance of power between the winners and losers of free trade. If on balance, the losers of free trade are more powerful, then you're likely to see protectionist policies in place. On the other hand, if the winners of free trade are more powerful and able to voice their opinion and get representatives to listen to their wishes, then we're more likely to see free trade in those sectors and in those countries.